श्री कृष्णा श्री कृष्णा श्री कृष्णा गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरु साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। That knowledge which is divided in the past, present and the future, that knowledge is called as mind. Mind is also knowledge and consciousness is also knowledge. The difference between these two types is, in one knowledge, the past, present, future division is valid. And in another knowledge, there is no division into past, present and future. And whenever we are functioning through the mind, the past, present and future becomes valid. And the surprising thing is, the mind is not influenced by time. Because time is a baby of mind. When mind is totally enfolded as in deep sleep, that time there is no time. There is not past, there is no present, there is no future. Because how the time is established? The time is born when a sequence is established. Like morning, one event. Then noon, second event. Then evening, third event. Then night, fourth event. So a sequence is established. And when the sequence is established, time is born. So all that which is subject to change comes under the influence of time. So when we talk about our life, what we talk about? We talk about always with reference to the past, present and future. See? When we talk about when we were children, when we were small, so the past. These days things are totally different, present. We don't know what is going to come in the future for our children, future. And thus we are constantly attacked by this principle of time. And till such time we are influenced by the time, we can never be happy. Therefore, how do we get out of this? So, what is that which is influenced by the time in our knowledge? And it is nothing but our own gross body. Our body is born in time. Our body keeps on growing in time. Then one day our body dies in time. So when we are identified with the body, then we keep on talking with reference to the time. Therefore you will see the old people, why they are not accepted in the younger generation? It is only for this reason. Whenever they are, they'll be all the time breaking their past. When we were children, we don't understand the basic principle that nobody is interested in our past. Everybody is concerned about their own future. But we people, old people, have nothing but the past. Old people have no future. What future they have? Only they are waiting for the death to come. One day I was sitting in my room, somebody dropped in. Swamiji, what are you doing? I said, I was waiting for death. No, Swamiji, don't say like that. I said, no, now I don't have to say, you have come already. Death is nothing but a sense of otherness. Dvitiyatvai bhayam bhavati. Therefore, we are all the time influenced by the past, present and the future. And how this influences, now the second step. When we talk about our childhood, our earlier days, childhood or earlier days, they belong to the body. Body was a child. Body was a teenage. Body was middle age. Body is old. Many old people say this thing. Once in our Kavaladham only, I was taking my breakfast or lunch, something like that. And one couple came and sat next to me. Swamiji, can I sit here? I said, I don't know whether you can sit or you don't sit. No, can I sit? I said, I don't know. How can I know whether you can sit or not? Then said, yeah, baitho kya hai, baitho. But why didn't you say earlier, yes? I said, because when you say, can I sit, how do I know your ability, whether you can sit or you cannot sit? Then you should ask, may I sit? Then I can tell you yes or no. Then he said, unknown to me. He said, I have come from Delhi. I said, okay. I didn't ask. Can you tell me what is my age? Second question. To an unknown person, when you ask this question, that person must be off his track. So, I said, maybe 5 years of age? No. Tell really. I said, I don't know. You know, I am 78 years. Then I said, stop. What? You are 78 years young, is it not? How do you know that? I was going to say young. Because when you are so much obsessed with the body, you can only think about young and old, nothing else. See, friends, this body, 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 that becomes such a terrible obsession. Until such time, we are obsessed with the body, we will never, never be happy in life. Therefore, one of the techniques of living in the body and yet going beyond the body, is it possible? Yes, it is possible. And this technique is given in Bhagavad Gita, where Bhagavan says in 3rd chapter, Mai sarvani karmani sanyasya dhyatma chetasa nirashi nirmamo bhutva yudhyasva vigata jvara. 4 or 5 principles are given in this verse. Bhagavan says, sarvani karmani mai sanyasya adhyatma chetasa. Adhyatma chetasa, in simple English, it will be in later and spirit. Sarvani karmani mai sanyasya. Whatever you are doing not for your sake. You are doing it for some higher purpose. Here God means some higher purpose. Whenever the goal of our life is higher, we are able to rise above the body identification. See, take one or two examples. One, the useless example. There are girls who dream of walking like a cat on a catwalk ramp. So they want to go and walk there. And for that, they have to have a figure. A person with a drum figure, 62, 62, 62, is not allowed to climb that ramp, isn't it? They require a figure. To maintain that figure, how much control they have to keep on their eating? They rise above their body identification. Thoda ice cream khai hi lo. No, calories are increasing. See? So when we have something higher to achieve, then only we will rise above the body. One example. Second example. See, this example is very difficult to digest. we may condemn the terrorist, but I tell you, their commitment to their cause, whether it is right or wrong, is not our concern. We have to learn. If you see the commitment of the terrorist for their cause is many, many million times more than the total government machinery, the complete army put together. See, whether they are big officers in the army, how much comforts, how much payment they have, and these terrorists, what they have? Nothing. And yet they are committed. See, friends, and their commitment is to the extent of they are ready to go beyond the body. Therefore, when our goal is clear and we are committed for that goal, then alone we rise above the body identification. Now the third example. This happened in Ahmedabad many years before. One young boy came, he, after my lecture was over, he was climbing the dais. I said, get down, I am coming down. But I have got a question, I said, you can ask there, let me come. So, he had a helmet in his hand, like a baby. He said, I have got a question. I said, okay, what is the question? What is wrong if I run after girls? Nothing wrong, run. Do you want a company? I can give you. No, you don't understand. What is wrong if I run after girls? I said, I also don't understand. What is wrong? There's nothing wrong. Run. This is the age you should run after girls. He got so frustrated. He expected I will start giving him a big sermon. No, my dear young man, you should not do like this thing. See, Bhagwan Ram, if you have to run, run after the deer like the Ram. Don't run after the girls. I'm not going to tell you that. Run, very good. He got so disgusted and again, you don't understand me somewhere. Look, keep cool. Then I told him, I said, this is not your question. Your question is, when you study, when you want to do something, you are unable to do that because your mind is constantly running here and there. You are not able to apply your mind to the given cause. Is it not? This is your question. Then he said, exactly, this is what I wanted to ask. Even our problems we don't know. See? Then I told him, I said, look here. Once I went to a school in Arunachal Pradesh. And there was, it's a girls' school up to class 8 or so. And there was hostel also, all the tribal girls staying there. And when my time of departure came, all the children all around, and then singing and all that. So when I was going, so one girl came and she said, Swamiji, close your eyes. We have got some prize for you. I said, okay, I close my eyes. Extend your palm and in there. So somebody will come and put something on your hand, and when we tell, then you should open and see. Then all right. So they did it. Open your eyes, I opened. There was nothing but a simple bookmark. In that remote area, what can you get? And on bookmark there was a message. All great achievements are possible through great sacrifice. If we want something higher in life, we have to rise from the lower. Now if our life is only eat, sleep, procreate, ahara, nidra, bhaya, maithunancha, four things. Ahara, eat, nidra, sleep, bhaya, sense of insecurity, and maithunancha, procreation. If this is all that we are dreaming in our life, we cannot rise above the body identification. See? And such people are lost only in sin and merit. All the time, leading a life of fearfulness. See? And such people who have been always living in this philosophy, in the old days, two thoughts torture them. One thought is, why did I do the wrong things in my life when I was young? And why I didn't do the right things which I was supposed to do when I was young? In the old days, this burden of the guilt that we carry on our mind is killing burden. See, this is written in Upanishad. And I have also experienced this from one, my friend, he is no more now. This happened in Assam. My friend's name was Sharma. He was that time about 78 and I was in my 20s. So everybody used to call him Guruji, I used to call him Guruji. Once I heard that he was not well, so I went to see him. And when I went to see him, I said, Guruji, how are you? His daughter also came. He was staying with his daughter, the only daughter. And he told her, you go inside, prepare something for Swamiji and don't come till I call you. And then I was sitting on the sofa. He got up from his bed and sat next to me, put his head on my shoulder and was crying pathetically. So again I said, Guruji, what happened? Please don't call me Guruji. I said, okay, I will not call you, but stop crying. So badly he was crying, as if something had terribly happened. And my interest was, my shirt was getting spoiled. When old people cry, leakages come from every hole. And then he said, everybody calls me Guruji. Because last 60 years in this town, no religious function was ever conducted without my presence. He was having very good voice and he will be singing bhajans. Any function, Hormaji, because in Assam, Sa is pronounced as Ha, Hormaji. And the Hormaji is there, you cannot have any program. So, he will be called and then he will start and then program starts. Slowly, slowly, he was addressed as Guruji. Then he said, Swamiji, I tell you sincerely, I don't have even this much of faith in God. Now I am regretting. I was only carried away by my own music. People are appreciating me. I never thought of something higher in life except playing the harmonium and singing without any meaning to that. Today I am regretting. My whole life I have been cheating myself. See, friends. Therefore, if we have to rise above the body identification, let us not get lost in the worldly achievements or failures. Because achievements and failures are valid with reference to the body only. See, friends, one of the most important things, we have to rise above that. And for that, Bhagavan Krishna gives this technique. Mai sarvani karmani sanyasya adhyatma chetasa. Whatever we are doing, let us do it not for our sake. Bhagavan Shankaracharya writes, Atma tvam girija mati sahachara prana shariram gruham pujati visheyopabhogarachana nidra samadhi sthitihi sanchara padayo pradakshinavidhi stotrani sarvagiro yad yad karma karo mitatta dakilam shambho tavaradhanam. Let every action of our life be done for some higher purpose, some higher cause. And whenever we do something higher, lower things automatically drop. And therefore, if we have got a higher goal in life, then body will not be a burden at all. So, to that boy who asked me this question, if I run after girls, what is wrong? I said, look here, if you fix a goal that you have to be first position holder in this examination, keep this as a goal. Work day and night. Nothing short of that. This body and the mind will not be a problem for you. Therefore, this body is used as an instrument for achieving something higher. Karmani karmani. Because all the karma, all the activities are done by the body. It is for this purpose. In our scriptures we are told various kinds of austerities. Follow, like, you know, the 4 months. In the 4 months, you should not eat onion, garlic, you should not eat non-vegetarian, you should not drink, you should not sleep late, you should get up early in the morning, finish your bath, do puja, read Ramayana, something or the other. Now, why this is given? Is it to torture us or what? Kya chahiye? Nahi, yeah, soni nahi, chandi nahi, kuch nahi. So, whatever we are told, it is not to torture us, but to discover, be attentive. All austerities are practiced in our life for us to rise above the body identification. Like, you know, in the month of Kartik, many places they do Kartik Snan. They do early morning, elderly ladies, you know, and those who are staying in this part of the world, very hot. For them, cold means what? If they see the picture of the ice, they start shivering. They don't have to go to north. They're so susceptible. Now, such ladies, they will be doing that cold water bath during that Kartik Snanam. Now, why they intend to torture? No. To discover. You can. We lack in our life self-confidence. Those who lack self-confidence, they can achieve nothing in life. We can, we must, we should. It is for this purpose, this is that. Similarly, we are dependent on many things in life. Without this, I can't. Without this, I can't. Like, you know, I have to go to many houses for taking food. And then they normally ask, Swamiji, what do you eat? Or what you don't eat? According, we'll prepare the food. So if it is a Punjabi house, I tell them, what I will not eat, that I will tell you. Rest of the things you can prepare. First of all, I don't eat non-vegetarian. Then I don't take onion, garlic, then tomato, then rajma, chole, bhature, bengal da parta, paneer. These things I don't eat. Now they are flat. Oh God, come. They can't think that cooking is possible without this. See, friends, we have to discover this freedom from dependence on worldly things and being. It is for this purpose that all austerities are meant. And this can be done if our commitment to higher cause is sincere. See, you must have seen, you know, on the TV or on YouTube, among the Tamilians, there is a sect. They are the followers of Murugan. Murugan is Kartikeya Swami. And particularly, I have seen in a very big way, Of course, in Tamil Nadu it is there, but outside India, in Malaysia, I have seen that. There, Penang, yes, I went there. And there was a big festival of this Tamilian. And they will be piercing their body by very sharp wires and nails. And the whole thing is pulled by those, you know, hooks which are put on their skin all around like a horse. And huge chariot containing their god is being pulled. Such a torture. It is not torture. It is one of the techniques. Rise above the body identification. You can. And to rise above the body identification, higher goal is necessary. So higher goal could be nothing but the divine principle. Now for us, what is the higher goal? Higher goal is, in this very life, we have to come to discover our essential divine nature. Upanishad very clearly says, Iha ched avedita asa satyam asti, na ched iha avedita mahati vinashti. While in this very body, if you come to discover your divine nature, then you have fulfilled your life. Otherwise, mahati vinashti, you have been given the best opportunity by the Lord to evolve and merge in Him. Instead of that, we are lost in the same mundane things. See? Mahati vinashti. In the 15th chapter, Bhagavan Sri Krishna says, Etat buddhva buddhiman syat krita krityascha bharat. Having known this truth, one attains fulfillment in life. See, friends, fulfilling the desires can never give you fulfillment in life. Fulfillment in life can come only when we come to discover our divine nature. See, therefore, mai sarvani karmani sannyasya adhyatma chetasa. Whatever we are doing, it is being done for the divine, not for us. Now next step. Whenever we do something for God, in simple words, for higher principle, that doing is exceptionally brilliant and beautiful. See? For example, those of you who have got your personal gods in your house and doing puja also. Not crucifying them on the wall, once for all, hang there, not like that. Those who have got their gods properly kept in a nice way and they are doing everyday puja, giving bath and giving the flowers and food, etc. So, when we do offering to the Lord, we give the best that we have. Suppose, after you have given the bath to the gods, now you have to dry, towel is required. So do we take the towel, the same cloth which was used for wiping the floor, bring that only with us? No. That cloth is not used for anything else. Now the naivedya, the offering which is given to the Lord, it is not yesterday's sandwich may be there in the fridge, panned out, offered to the God. No. Fresh, unused, best. In the same manner, whenever, whatever we are doing, it is done as an offering to the Lord. See, friends, the attitude will change. Now, whatever we are doing is not being done to fulfill our desires, but it is done as an offering to the divine. Now, be attentive. Earlier talk we have heard, that life should be duty oriented. So when we are fulfilling our duties, likes and dislikes will not come in our way. Whether we like or we don't like, who cares? This is your duty, you have to do. Suppose there is somebody appointed as a hangman and a person comes to be hanged and he says, no, I am following ahimsa paramo dharma. You have no business. You have to hang that man to death. See, friends, Therefore, when the duties are done, we rise above the likes and dislikes. But when we do or fulfill the duties, that time what happens? I is still maintained. I am not like other people, irresponsible. I do my duty. I have taken care of my children. I got them educated. I got them married. And I am making their wives suffer because of me. Those who are fulfilling their duty, they have got this terrible arrogance of doership. So, duty is okay as a KG1 state. Now we have to convert the duty into devotion. When you do duty, you get retired in life. See, government servants get retired in life. You know the meaning of retired? Even government is really tired of you, therefore retired. A devotee never gets tired. Therefore, a devotee is never retired. See, because devotion is not a duty. It is a joy. See, and whenever anything we do to get happiness, it is a burden, it is a bondage. But whenever anything you do to express joy, to express happiness, it is a freedom. See, there are two types of persons who are doing the puja. One example I can give you is Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. He was a pujari in a Kali temple. And throughout the country you can see there are so many temples and so many pujaris are appointed. See the difference between the two. All others are doing the puja for earning their bread. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, he was not doing the puja as an appointed servant and he had to do the duty, but it was his devotion. And therefore, the job remained the same. One person did the same job as a duty, got the labor charges called as a salary. See, friends, the other person did the same job as a devotion and got liberation. See the difference? Therefore, initially, we have to begin with the duty. But don't carry the burden of duty throughout life. Let that duty be converted into devotion. And it can happen only when the attitude towards karma or action changes. So, yad yad karma karobi tat tad akhilam shambho tava aradhana. Therefore, Bhagavan says, my sarvani karmani, all your activities, you are doing it for my sake. Not for anybody. In Ramayana, the story of Shabari comes. She was told by her guru that you chant Ram, 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 Ram. Then she said, what is the meaning of this? So the guru told, you don't worry, the meaning will manifest before you. It's okay. And she was doing that with a hope. Every day, any day he may come. He will not come by giving a SMS, I am coming. No. Anytime he will come. And as a result, every day her ashram was so perfectly maintained. Maybe he comes today. See the difference? For us, when some guests are coming in our house, then we clean everything. Otherwise, Ram Krishna Govinda. See, friends, therefore, a devotee is ever ready. A person who is doing duty, he will tell, you never told me you are coming. How can we keep our house clean? Because we live like a bug. No cleanliness. See, friends, mai sarvani karmani sanyasya adhyatma chetasa. A devotee is a perfectionist. A devotee is never tired. A devotee is ever inspired. A devotee is doing everything to express the joy, and he discovers fulfillment in his action. He doesn't want fulfilling desire through his actions. Then mai sarvani karmani sanyasya adhyatma chetasa. Sanyasya doesn't mean sannyas. See? Nyasa means placement. Shilanyas. The shilanyas of this building was done by Mr. So and so. Shilanyas, nyas means placement. Sanyas means proper placement. Meaning everything that we do in our life is done as if it is the worship of the Lord out of devotion. So, here the goal is fixed. This is the goal. Now, what are the factors which pull us away from our dedication to the goal? There are basically three factors. One factor is the past, the second factor is the future, and the third factor is the present. Therefore, the teacher says, Nirashi Nirmamo Bhutva Yudhyasva Vigata Jvaraha. First of all, Nirmamo Bhutva. Mamata is possessiveness. And possessiveness is always with reference to the past. Future we cannot possess because it is not yet born. Nirmamo Bhutva. Drop your past once for all. Never bring your past memories to spoil the present. I'll give an example. There was one student, very good student, and in one examination, maybe second or third year, when he was supposed to appear for the examination, he got some food poisoning or whatever. And he was having loose motion and vomition and dehydration, immediately admitted to the ICU, given drip, and somehow he survived. Natural examination gone. Then, next time when the examination came, again those symptoms started developing in him, although there was nothing. And again it happened, again he failed. Failed means could not appear for the examination. When it happened once or twice or thrice, thereafter he developed that fear. I cannot pass, I cannot pass. And every teacher knew he is a good student. But the moment the examination comes, all his endocrine balances to get upset, psyche is to be paralyzed, and he will be in the hospital. After the examination, he is normal again. No problem. So, these memories of the past destroyed his next opportunity. This is what happens with many of us. The past failures, they give such a big impact on our present that we are unable to perform as we should have performed because of the past memories. You will see many people, when they are doing anything, always talk about the past. They cannot remain in the present. One of the spiritual practice to rise above the body, try this. Don't ask anybody about their past. Don't talk about your past. Try. But we being Indians, we have to write everybody's kundali. When are you born? Where are you born? Why are you born? Why don't you die? Why did you get married? If you are not married, why don't you get? If you get married, why did you get married? Is it necessary? But we have to ask. And as a result, our hard disk is filled with unwanted data. And then the new information about the truth, no place. Anything you want to add, there is no space in your heart, is first empty. No, the past memories are very empty. This is one of the highest spiritual practice, to rise above the body level. Past belongs to the body, not to you. You are always present. Your body as a child has disappeared. Your body as a teenager has disappeared. Your body as a middle age has disappeared. Your body as an old age will also disappear, but you continue to be. Dehinosmin yatha dehe kaumaram yauvanam jara tatha dehantara praptihi dhiras tatra namuyati. Bhagavad Gita says, this body has these various stages, the child, the middle age, etc. But the embodied that we are, who is expressing through the body and yet not influenced by the limitations of the body, that is our essential nature. See, friends, therefore, how we get caught up is because of this past memories. And when you talk about the same thing again and again, you start believing it has really happened. Give it a chance. Just repeat it to 100,000, many times to many people. That, you know, when I was young, I happened to be in the same place where Swami Vivekananda was taking food. And I went there and he told me, hey, come on child. And I went and he fed me with his own hands. Say it 100 times. One day you start believing it has happened. See? The power of thought is so much that what is not, start imagining it has happened. And therefore, this past is the burden of the body that we carry. Past belongs to the body, not to us. If we have to rise above the body, we have to go beyond the body. Don't refer anything with reference to body, particularly the past. Now, to achieve this, if you observe your own performance, you will come to know, whenever we talk to others, we always talk about our past. I was there, I did this thing, I did that thing, continue, same thing in the past. One day I was traveling from Bombay to Delhi in train, many years before, and one huge structure came and landed in front of me. And he said, oh Swamiji, you are here, very good. Now our time will pass nicely. I said, my God, now this fellow is going to eat my head for next 18 hours. So, like a terrorist takes out AK-47, I took out my rosary, mala, japa mala from my pocket. And I told him, excuse me, I do my japa when we travel, so I will not be able to talk to you. Okay, I am sorry. And so I kept quiet, I don't have to talk. He said, can I talk? No, I can say no. Okay. And then he started. In 47, when India was partitioned, that means last 60 years account year to year now. Now who is interested? He went on and on and on and on. And when he came ultimately, then my children told, here the climate is very humid, you get asthma, you go to Delhi, it will be better. And therefore, I am going to Delhi in this train. So they brought me and put me in this train. Thereafter, when you come in the utter present, you have nothing to talk. How simple it is. Therefore, when you stop talking about your past, you will not be interested in anybody's past. Who has come, who has gone, how does it matter? It makes no difference. And when this nirmamo bhutva, we drop the past, achievements as well as failures, regrets as well as good things, everything we have to drop, nirmamo bhutva. And nirashi bhutva, nirashi, asha, expectation is with respect to future. And when we want to all the time project in the future and want to imagine what is going to happen, what is going to happen, we will destroy ourselves. See, in Bhagavad Gita, there is one verse which I referred the other day in different manner. When it is said, karmanne vadhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana, the one youngster asked this question. He said, Swamiji, because of this shloka of Bhagavad Gita, India is not progressing. I said, I wish this happens. Because who studies Bhagavad Gita? Because you people say, do your karma and don't have expectation of results. Without that, who will work? I said, my dear friend, if you understand little coolly, you will see. Whatever you are doing, if you do that wholeheartedly, remaining completely available, you are bound to succeed. But if you are all the time only worried, you are writing your paper in the present and you are worried about what college admission will I get, in which college I get, can you write your paper? So what is meant is, when you are doing your job in the present, remain in the present totally. Instead of remaining in the present totally, what we do, either the regrets of the past or the worries of the future, they torture us into pieces and we are not available in the present. See, friends, such a person who is not fully available in the present, can he perform the job best? See, friends, therefore, it is not that don't expect, it is not said do the job and don't take the salary. No. Do your job best and discover happiness in doing the job, not from the job. If attention is on the time, what will I get, what will I get, then you are not following the right path. See? Therefore, nirashi bhutva, don't unnecessarily go into the imaginary future and try to solve the non-existing problems. This is the habit most of us have. Go on imagining. I don't know what is going to happen. I don't know what is going to happen. If you don't know, relax. How simple is it? If you know, prepare. Worrying is not a solution. Once I was coming from New Zealand to Australia. So immigration we have to go. And there was one of the, you know, passenger. He had some argument with the immigration officer. And immediately the, you know, security people were called and he was pulled away. So all the, you know, passengers there, they were tense. There is no appeal anywhere. So me and my friend told me, Swamiji, see, let us pray, we don't go to that man, he is already upset. He will ask 101 questions. I said, why do you imagine? It's okay. He has done his job. We go our job. No, no, no. Keep your ticket properly. And he may ask, show me the other ticket. Oh. He was so tense. I said, relax, man. Everything will be all right. And it so happened, we were directed towards him, to that particular immigration agent. So, my friend, we went together. He held my hand, pressed. Relax. And I presented my passport. He saw it, put stamp, and go ahead. Not one question, not one word. I am so relieved. I said, you are unnecessarily worried. Suppose he will ask this question. Suppose he will ask, why do you imagine? And when you just start imagining unnecessarily, your energy is destroyed. See, friends, 1 hour, rather 8 hours of physical work is equal to 1 hour of speech. 8 hours of speech is equal to 10 minutes of ordinary thinking. 8 hours of ordinary thinking is equal to 5 minutes of intense contemplation. This is the energy consumption. Doing physical job is easy. Talking sales for hours together consumes more energy. Similarly, talking is easy. Contemplation and thinking is very difficult. It takes lot of energy. And worries are the channels through which we lose most of our energy. And such people, they have got all the comforts and they are comfortably miserable. They have got all the luxuries, they are luxuriously miserable. Because they have never thought about it, that we are wasting our energy by going in the past or going in the future. Now see these two channels, where our energy is wasted and we remain a slave to the body. About the past, we can do nothing. You cannot undo your past. Then what is to be done? Select, shift, delete. Only one thing you can do. Drop the past. You cannot improve. But if we ourselves are holding on to, who can help us? Now about the future. About the future where it is not yet born. Why worry? Because worry is nothing but trying to solve the non-existing problems of future. When these two channels are blocked, we start remaining in the present. And when we start remaining in the present, then yujyasya vigata jvaraha. Now the third channel, where we are totally lost in our life, is excitement. Jvara means fever. Don't live in this world as if you are under attack of some influenza. Many times it happens. People come for satsang here and there. Then they get the spiritual influenza. Okay, from tomorrow I will start getting early in the morning. And they decide to get up 4 o'clock in the morning. Put the alarm and all that. Everything okay. 4 o'clock. His sleep is also over. Then Mr. Mind comes and says, you old man, now you are 70. In your whole life, you never woke up so early. What was wrong? Unnecessarily you listen to these useless Babajis. They have nothing to do. Therefore they keep on telling some impossible things. And you listen to them. Forget about it. Let us not waste time and go to sleep. Again, as usual, we get up at 10 o'clock. And then we start feeling disgusted. Oh God, today also I could not. But that day in satsang I thought I would be able to do it. Because in satsang it was influenza. Attack has come. Spiritual life is not a spiritual influenza. It has to go slow and steady. So one of the techniques of rising above the body identification is remain cool. Don't react. Normally we react in life. Reactions are many ways. One of the reaction is default setting. Default settings are whether somebody asks or doesn't ask, we have to say. I should not say, but I am telling that our neighbor's daughter-in-law is far better than ours. When you know, you should not say, why don't you keep your mouth shut? This is reaction. Instead of reacting, start responding. Response is when you are asked, then only talk. And before talking, ask 10 times, is it necessary to talk? That is the response. Then alone, this fever of present will slowly subside. Yudhyasva vigata jvaraha. Second thing that happens is, in the present, our mind gets lost in comparisons. Non-stop comparisons. He is like that, she is like that, this place is like that, that place is like that, this time is like that, that time is like that. And what do we achieve by comparison? Nothing. But this is how our mind keeps us busy, either in the past or in the present, through comparisons or the future through worries. Now, as none of us want to die, so also the mind doesn't want to die. So to live, what we do, we have to take food. The food for the mind is thoughts. Thoughts pertaining to the past memories, thoughts pertaining to the future worries, thoughts pertaining to the present comparisons. If you stop your past regrets, if you stop future worries, and in the present, if you stop total comparisons, net result is mind will die. The death of the mind is like this. Take an ice cube, and if you throw the ice cube in, let us say, lake or the ocean, the ice cube will remain for some time. In due time, slowly it will lose its individuality, identity, name and form. Everything will be slowly dissolved. And will the ice cube disappear? Yes and no. It will disappear as a name and a form, but it will not disappear. It will merge with the totality. In the same manner, when the mind dies, it is not a death, but it is the real birth. We come back to our divine self. He fails. Therefore, mai sarvani karvani sanyasyadhyatma chetasa nirashi nirmamo bhutva yudhyasva vigata jvaraha. Yudhyasva doesn't mean fight. Yudhyasva means lead your life as you are on the war front. War footing, that is the phrase in English. Living life on the war footings. So when you are on the war front, and if the enemy is coming in front, do we say, hey, come on, yeah, today don't disturb me, today is my casual leave? No. Every moment we have to be ready, any time. In the same manner, our spiritual life is not a part-time profession. Half an hour meditation, rest of the day frustration. 20 minutes maunam, thereafter fighting and shouting. No. It is a full-time preoccupation. We have to get fully involved in this. Therefore, yudhyasva, don't lead your life because, like, you know, the Hindi cinema song, gam uthane ke liye. No, we are not living here just to live through. No, let us discover fulfillment in life. And fulfillment in life can happen only if we use the body to go beyond the body. How simple it is. But unless that goal is known to us, unless the goal is fixed by us, we will be only all the time lost, only saying, I eat good food, I had this calorie, I had that cholesterol, and I do this yoga, and I do this pranayam, and I go to the temple, only that and nothing beyond it. That cannot be the goal of life. Friends, in this manner, Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavan Sri Krishna gives us this beautiful technique that we can live in this very body and yet we can transcend the limitations of the body and discover fulfillment in our life. Sri Krishna Narayana. ओम पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ओम शांति शांति शांति। हरिः ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। हरिः ओम।